Yep, retired from Yale. I recommend retirement to everybody. Of course, you have to have something from which to retire, and that's prevents some of you from retiring. Thanks to Biola for hosting this really interesting sounding conference and to the Amundsens for their support of it. Yeah, I retired quite a while ago. I don't do PowerPoint, but I do have some photos that I'd like you to see. So Jonathan Anderson here is going to take care of that. Jonathan, in advance, thank you for that. Friend of mine took some of these photos, Paul Staub. I agreed to give him credit. And I don't know who took the others. Every Sunday, for almost 2,000 years, Christians have left their homes, their places of work and recreation, to assemble with other Christians. Upon concluding their assembly, they return to their homes, their places of work and recreation. And 7 days later, they repeat this pattern of assembling and dispersing. The significance of this familiar but curious systolic-diastolic rhythm cries out for reflection. What does it mean? But that's for another day. Sometimes Christians have conducted their assemblies out in the open, on a riverbank, on a hilltop, in a clearing in the woods, but usually they've conducted their assemblies within an enclosure. And my topic of reflection with you this evening is the enclosures that Christians have constructed for their assemblies. More specifically, I want to engage in some normative reflections on these enclosures. How should we who are Christians think about these enclosures? And about the places and spaces enclosed, and how should we design and build them? Now, I've got to say a few words about how I understand architecture, and that's, you know, dangerous since I'm not an architect, but only a philosopher, but here goes. I would define architecture as the art of enclosing places, a place being an area on the face of the earth. Our English word enclosure is ambiguous. It can mean either the place that is enclosed or that which does the enclosing. And I'm going to be using it in the latter sense, as that which does the enclosing. So architecture, so it seems to me, is the art of enclosure. When I say that architecture is the art of enclosure, I mean to include not only the construction of an enclosure, but the carving out of an enclosure. Among the most amazing examples of that in my experience is the ancient city of Petra in present-day Jordan. Now, constructed enclosures, as opposed to the carved out ones, have both an inside and an outside. Some have a ceiling or roof, some don't. And they vary enormously in the degree of what I'll call their porosity to things entering from outside. Daylight, weather, noise, smells, insects, animals, human intruders, and so forth. Is the sound okay? Okay. Two lines of trees enclosing a lane are fairly close to the ultimate in porosity, and an igloo, so I assume, I've never actually been in one, is the ultimate in non-porosity. Now, we human beings enclose places on the face of the earth for the sake of certain activities that we want to perform within those places. And we judge that enclosing the place and doing so in a particular way will enable, enhance, and maybe fit those activities. The activities might be relatively passive. Sometimes we enclose a place because we want to protect something located there from the elements, some plant, some rock, some artifact of historical significance, whatever. Sometimes we enclose a place because we want to keep animals from escaping, or because we want to store things there. Now, these are all things we do. They're not things done to us. But as I say, they're kind of passive compared to, say, playing basketball. Now, the Dutch scholar Gerardus van der Leeuw, working in the first half of the 20th century, was an extraordinary polymath who published important books in four areas: anthropology, theology, liturgics, and theological aesthetics. And in the enormously rich and provocative book that he published in the middle of his career that he called Sacred and Profane Beauty, The Holy in Art, he remarks, quote, that in the place of the house of God comes now the house of prayer. Man, that's his word translation here, man no longer builds a holy place, but rather builds himself a place in which he can pray to God in peace. Let me alter van der Leeuw's terminology just a little bit and say the same thing. What he's saying is that we no longer enclose places that we regard as holy or sacred, but instead enclose places within which we can pray to God in peace. Is that right? Correct. Well, what would make a place on the face of the earth holy or sacred? Indeed, what's meant in calling a place holy or sacred? And is van der Leeuw correct in suggesting that the significance of the enclosures in which Christians assemble on Sundays is not, if it ever was, that they enclose sacred spaces? Suppose you were planning a new city somewhere out in an unbuilt environment. You're like Lafayette, planning Washington, D.C., out in some swampy area off the Potomac. Would it make sense to ask yourself whether there are any sacred places in the area, so as to be sure not to build on them, or to build only a sanctuary of some sort? The paganism of Greco-Roman antiquity, to mention only that form of paganism, recognized lots of places that were sacred antecedent to building. The most famous probably being that place in Delphi, where fumes of some sort came out of the earth and inspired the Delphic oracle. And Rudolf Otto, in his well-known book, The Idea of the Holy, conceptualized the notion of such sacred places with the category of the numinous. Human beings, he said, have experienced certain places as numinous, a mixture of dread and attraction, or have found themselves having experiences repeatedly in certain, numinous experiences in certain places. Now, the Hebrew and Christian scriptures, as I read them, repudiate all such forms of nature religion. The Old Testament writers do speak of Mount Zion as holy, but to the best of my knowledge, there's no suggestion that the temple was located on Mount Zion because the mountain was regarded as antecedently sacred, in the way in which the Greeks regarded Delphi as sacred. It was the other way around. Mount Zion was holy because the temple was located there. Now it's true, I think, it's true that in the thought world of Judaism and Christianity, there are analogs of a certain sort to paganism's conviction that certain places are inherently holy. Mount Sinai is a holy place for both Jews and Christians. And Jesus' purported birthplace in Bethlehem and purported burial place in Jerusalem are sacred places for Christians. And the antecedent sacredness of these places is what determined the location of the monastery of St. Catherine at the foot of Mount Sinai, of the Church of Nativity in Bethlehem, and of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. But I think we got to make two observations here. First, these places are regarded by Christians as antecedently holy to the buildings that now enclose them, in a quite different way from that in which paganism regarded certain places as antecedently holy to anything being built there. I think it's like this. The place in Jerusalem in which Jesus was purportedly buried resembles the shroud of Turin in which he was purportedly wrapped, in that both of them are relics of some of God's most decisive actions among us. A relic shroud, a relic place. And so too the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem resembles a piece of the true cross, in that both of them are relics of Christ. A relic place, a relic sliver. And second, that the monastery and the two churches that I just mentioned are located at places antecedently regarded as holy relic places, that's just not true for the great bulk of places where Christians assemble on Sundays. There are far too few places regarded by Christians as antecedently holy relic places for that to be what determines the location of our churches. There are a lot more such antecedently relic places than I've mentioned. I remember the one on the island of Patmos, the church built over where St. John purportedly received his revelations. It's a wonderful spot on the face of the earth. But there are altogether just too few such relic places for that to determine where we're going to locate our churches. So what do you think? I think Vanderleo is right in his claim that the significance of the enclosures within which Christians assemble on Sundays is not that these places were antecedently sacred places. Their significance is instead that they enclose places within which, to use his words, we can pray to God in peace. What he means by that is that they're places in which we can celebrate the liturgy. Now, thus far, I've spoken with deliberate vagueness about Christians assembling on Sundays. I haven't said why they assemble. They assemble to perform their liturgy, their worship. And I submit that, at least as I see it, reflections on church architecture should begin by asking what sort of enclosure the liturgy calls for. What sort of enclosure would enhance, would enable and enhance and fit the liturgy? There are other considerations, considerations of justice, considerations of affordability. But here's my main thesis. I think it's that with what liturgy calls for, that reflection should begin. The thesis is really an application of a general point, to church architecture of a general point. I think in general it's true that one should begin one's reflections on how to enclose some place by identifying the activities to be performed in that place, and then asking what will enable, enhance, and fit those activities. That, in my view, is how the house architect should begin. Now, what the house architect discovers in talking with families is that though there are commonalities from family to family, I take it that almost all families want a house in which they can sleep. Might be some exceptions to that. Different families want different things out of domestic life. And they think of domestic life in different ways. And those differences call for different enclosures. And so too for liturgy. There is no such thing as a common Christian liturgy, nor any such thing as a common Christian understanding of liturgy. There are commonalities, but different congregations perform different liturgies and embrace different understandings of their liturgy. And I submit that those differences call for different sorts of enclosures. The principle I proposed, once again, is that one should begin one's reflections on how to enclose some place by identifying the activities to be performed in that place, and then asking what will enable, enhance, and fit those activities. Obvious, though, I kind of hope that principle is when stated abstractly like that. It doesn't by any means describe how things always go. Sometimes a house architect has an innovative design in mind and manages to cajole his clients into fitting their activities into his design rather than fitting his design to their activities. And sometimes a congregation never goes beyond elementary functional considerations in asking what it does in its liturgy and how it understands it and what kind of enclosure that calls for. Let me describe for you what is for me, in my experience, the most striking example of such obliviousness. About 5 years ago, I was invited to give an evening talk in a church about 20 miles south of my home city of Grand Rapids, Michigan. I accepted the invitation because I knew the fellow who issued the invitation, but I didn't know a thing about the congregation and a thing about its building. When I arrived, I discovered that their building was an adapted warehouse, to which they had added a not unattractive entrance enclosure, and the whole thing was entirely surrounded by tarred parking lot. The worship space was a box. It had a flat ceiling with exposed pipes. The ceiling, the pipes, and the walls were, believe me, all painted black. There were small windows in the side walls. Since I was speaking in the evening, no light was coming in from outside. The artificial lighting, hanging down from the black flat ceiling, consisted of spotlights, these creating pools of bright light amidst shadows. And the seating consisted of individual chairs all lined up, facing a high platform, on which there was a lectern, or if you will, a pulpit. My guess is that in deciding how to adapt the warehouse for their assemblies, the members of this congregation never went beyond elementary functional considerations. Was the seating adequate for the membership? Could everybody see the preacher? Could they afford it? I say this not because I talked with anybody in attendance that evening about why this building was the way it was, but because I was then and remain unable to imagine, maybe you're better at it than I am, unable to imagine any practice and understanding of the Christian liturgy that would call for such an enclosure. Some of you here might be inclined to speak up in their defense by speculating that maybe they had very little money. Probably so. But the last time I checked, white paint cost no more than black. Several times over, I've said that when designing an enclosure for certain activities, one should ask what sort of enclosure would fit those activities, and fit how those activities are understood by those who are performing them. Now, a few of you, I have discovered, will know from reading my book, Art in Action, what I have in mind by that little word, fit. But not everybody has read my book. So let me explain ever so briefly what I've got in mind by fit. I'll do so by inviting you to play a brief game of ping pong, okay? It's in the book. We'll do it. Take the two words ping and pong. I will now mention pairs of things, and I want you to raise your hand and tell me which member of each pair fits better with ping and which fits better with pong. And it's important that to your own self you be true. Don't allow yourself to be influenced in your opinions by the people surrounding you. Got it? Ping, pong, I'll give you pairs, and you tell me which goes best. Ping, pong. Who, light object, heavy object. Who thinks that light object goes with ping and heavy object with pong? Who would say the other? One person, one bold person, okay. Ping pong. Large object, small object. Who says large goes with ping and small goes with pong? One person, okay. Fast, slow. Who says that fast goes with ping and slow with pong? Dissent? No dissenters on that one. Warm pea soup, ice cream. Who says that warm pea soup goes with ping and ice cream with pong? Four people, five, six, okay. You still remember what elm trees look like? You know these? They're pretty much died out. But, and you know what fir trees look like, right? If you don't know what these trees look like, you can't vote, okay? Fir tree, elm tree. Who says that fir goes with ping and elm with pong? Who would reverse it? Oh, that's about 50-50, interesting. Now this next one is a little bit sexist, but... Matron, pretty girl. Who says matron is ping and pretty girl is pong? Nobody on that one. Trumpet sound, cello sound. Who says that trumpet is ping and cello is pong? Dissenters? About six dissenters. Oh, let's take one last one. You know Rembrandt's paintings. You all are familiar with the art. So you all know Rembrandt's paintings and you all know Matisse's paintings, right? Who would say that Rembrandt is ping and Matisse is pong? One, two, three, okay, four. Let me explain what I think is going on here. Within reality, there are what you can call continuums, continua of qualities, or let me call them modalities. And we often specify these continua, or modalities, by antonym pairs. Fast, slow, big, small, loud, soft, sharp, dull, and so forth. And obviously we can and do make comparisons within these modalities. A speed of 30 miles per hour is more like a speed of 20 miles per hour than it is like a speed of 80 miles per hour. But here's my suggestion. I think we also do, and that's what was going on, I think we also can and do make comparisons across modalities. And I think that's what you were doing when you told me which member of each pair fit better with ping and which fit better with pong. So what I mean by fittingness is that cross-modal similarity, keeping in mind, of course, that similarity comes in degrees. And now for the application to our topic. I've been talking about places and enclosures of places, a place being an area on the face of the earth. Now, the place that is enclosed existed before it was enclosed. But when a place is enclosed, then the enclosure brings something else into existence, a bounded interior space. Or in case the enclosure contains a number of rooms and passageways, a number of interior, a bounded interior spaces. Space as such has no boundaries, and of course we don't create it. But by enclosing a place, we bring into existence one or more bounded interior spaces. The enclosure doesn't create the place. The place was there, we enclosed it. It creates this bounded interior space. Earlier, I posed the question whether some places on the face of the earth are holy or sacred, antecedent to being enclosed. That question about places is, to my mind, different, clearly different from a question easily confused with it. Namely, whether some spaces are holy or sacred. I'll be getting back to that one. Now, by virtue of being bounded in a certain way and having a certain size and so forth, an interior space has a certain shape and size. And that shape and size give it a character, an expressive character. We're all familiar with this. Some bounded interior spaces are cozy. Some are majestic. Some are intimate. Some are soaring. And by virtue of their expressive character, some bounded interior spaces fit, my little word, fit certain activities better than they fit other activities. and fit certain understandings of those activities better than they fit other understandings. And the same, of course, goes for the enclosure, too. It's also got an expressive character. Consider the typical Protestant church building. The space is a channel, a tube. The ceiling may be rather high. Nonetheless, the dominant axis of the space is horizontal. Further, the pews give to this space an unmistakable directionality. The space is arrowed forward, culminating in a raised platform with a pulpit, maybe a communion table, sometimes choir stalls. It's no accident that rather often one hears members of such churches refer to the sanctuary as the auditorium. It is an auditorium. And contemporary megachurches with their sloped floors and high and large platforms are even more obviously auditoria. The people are assembled to hear a religious message and to listen to religious music. Okay, my discussion thus far has been general and abstract. It's been, what would you expect? It's been philosophical. Now I'm going to put some flesh on these dry bones by describing for you how an actual congregation went about designing its building in the light of its liturgy and its understanding of its liturgy. The congregation is my own, Church of the Serpent, back in Grand Rapids, Michigan. The design process took place in the late 1980s, and the building itself was built in the early 1990s. I was a member of the committee responsible for formulating an architectural program, selecting an architect, and then working with the architect in the design process. The architect we chose was Gunnar Burkertz, a well-known architect with offices near Detroit, Birmingham, who had designed a quite surprising variety of sizable buildings around the world, including some churches, and who taught in the School of Architecture at the University of Michigan. So I'm going to describe some of the considerations, I won't have time for all of them, that went into our formulation of the architectural program, without on this occasion making any attempt whatsoever to defend these considerations. My aim here is to illustrate how to think about the design of a church building, not to argue that the specifications we gave to our architect are the best ones or the right ones or the only ones or anything of the sort. My view is that congregations that understand and practice the liturgy quite differently from how Church of the Servant does should design and build quite different buildings. Church of the Servant was founded in the early 1970s. It met for almost two decades in school gymnasia that it rented. So its liturgical practices and convictions were well in place before it designed and built its own building. There are two worship services every Sunday morning, and both include the Lord's Supper as an integral component of the service. At the moment when the bread is to be received, and the wine is to be received and eaten, and the wine is to be received and drunk, the worshipers come forward in a succession of groups, each group forming a circle at the front of the sanctuary, and the people pass the bread and the wine to each other. This liturgical practice implied an obvious functional consideration. The building had to be designed so that this liturgical practice of going forward, forming a circle, returning to one seat, would not be cumbersome, but would flow naturally. The practice had a less obvious implication as well. It seemed to us that if the number of worshipers was larger than roughly 500, communion would take too long. So we instructed the architect to design a sanctuary that would comfortably seat roughly 500 people. The members of the congregation also get out of their seats to bring their gifts forward at the time of the offering. Our reason for this practice is that it seems to us to fit the liturgical action of the offering far better than having everybody remain in his or her seat and having deacons come around to collect. collecting is not exactly offering. Incidentally, it's worth adding that there's good evidence that bringing one's gifts forward was also practiced in some of the early churches, at least we know in the very early Church of Rome. Let me move on to a central theme in our architectural program that was a blend of function and expressiveness. We spent some time discussing how we understand what we're doing when we assemble for the liturgy. And our answer in brief was that we understood ourselves as the family of God, brothers and sisters of Christ, assembled around word and sacrament to address God in song, prayer, and acclamation, to attend to what God has to say to us, and to celebrate the Lord's Supper as a memorial of Jesus. It is we who enact the liturgy. The preachers and the musicians don't do it for us. We have not assembled to witness a performance, but all together to perform the actions of the liturgy. I think that if this is one's understanding of what takes place in the assembly, it would never occur to one to design and build a typical traditional Protestant church building, let alone a megachurch. What would you do instead? Well, several things. First, you'd give the architect the really challenging task of designing an interior space in which the horizontal and the vertical or transcendental dimensions are balanced. The horizontal dimension reflecting the fact that this is the gathering of a family, and the vertical reflecting the fact that the family is not assembled for a potluck, but to worship and attend to God. And if the architect says, I have no idea how I can balance both vertical and horizontal dimensions, you say, then we have to get another architect. Second, one will not line the people up in straight rows facing forward, but will seat them in a semicircle around word and sacrament, pulpit and table, with the enclosure and the space shaped accordingly. An obvious question is, why a semicircle? Why not a circle? Congregations have occasionally, and do occasionally, build circular buildings with pulpit and table in the center. I'm told that many of the original Huguenot churches, all now destroyed, were originally octagonal or circular. In my view, there are two considerations against such a configuration. I think it makes preaching extremely difficult. Visualize. What is the preacher to do? Constantly rotate? But I also think that the expressive significance of a circle is not right. It too strongly suggests completeness. Yes, we are the family of God, the company of redeemed, but we're still on the way. And we have to architecturally express that tension. Third, gathering as the family of God around word and sacrament requires one or more leaders or presiders to lead in the prayers, to read scripture, to preach, to preside at the Lord's table. And these leaders or presiders will naturally have a position at the center of the semicircle. And they'll have to be somewhat elevated so that people can see and hear them. But how much should they be elevated? How much should they be separated from the people? Different liturgical theologies and different theologies of ordination will give different answers. Our own answer was that the separation should be relatively minimal. Now our architect, Gunnar Burkitz, seems to me have just succeeded quite brilliantly in designing an enclosure and an interior space that fit this understanding of the liturgy as the family of God assembled around word and sacrament. But only after I have introduced some additional considerations can I explain how he accomplished the most challenging part of that task, keeping the vertical and the horizontal in tension. Any congregation that plans to construct a building for itself has to make a choice of materials. A rather large number of different considerations go into that choice, including considerations of fittingness. Different materials say different things. Marble and glass, same glass, say something different from cement block and drywall. In our case, expense was an important consideration. We didn't have much money. Many members of the congregation would have argued against expensive materials anyway, but since they were out of the question, we didn't have to have the arguments. Our discussion with Burkitz on this point was fascinating. The issue of materials came up in one of the early meetings. There was a bit of talk about the obvious point that since our budget was low, the materials had to be basic. But a little voice inside of me, Nick Wolterstorff, impelled me to add, "Your challenge, Mr. Burkitz, will be to use ordinary materials in such a way that the dignity of the ordinary is revealed. You can use exposed steel, provided you use it in such a way that people say, 'I had no idea steel could be so beautiful.'" Burkitz was quiet for quite a while, looking down, and I began to worry. Had I insulted him? Then he looked up and said, "I think I understand what you are saying. A dumpy woman can wear silk and still look dumpy. An elegant woman can wear burlap and still look elegant. What you want, if I understand you, is an elegant burlap building. Is that correct?" We burst into laughter. He'd caught it exactly. And that's what the building is. Exposed steel framing, sealed concrete floor, cement block, drywall, and a new translucent material, building material, that I think I saw around here somewhere called cowl wall, about 6 inches thick, all used with great elegance. The dignity of the ordinary is revealed. At a subsequent meeting, Burkitz raised another issue pertaining to materials and budget. "Nowadays, we can build long spans with steel," he said, "but the longer the span, the more expensive. Will you let me use a post to reduce the length of the spans?" One of us replied, "Sure, provided that when people see it, they don't say, 'Too bad he had to put that post there.'" I now think that Burkitz was in fact being cunning. There is indeed a post, as we shall shortly see, but it does not function to reduce the length of any spans. Earlier I suggested that a fundamental component of architecture is the shape and size of the interior space. Let me now add that what's also important is how light plays within that space. And as preparation for our work, we on the design committee visited a number of churches in the area that had recently been constructed. Almost all of them were dark inside. Big swooping roofs coming down low, sometimes with a light scoop up front, sending a shaft of light onto the front wall over the pulpit. And my guess is that probably most people, when they think of church interiors, think of them as dark, darkish. We on the committee felt intuitively that this was wrong. In my own case, I had the New Testament letter of 1 John 1 ringing in my ear. God is light, and in God there is no darkness at all. If we walk in the light as God himself is in the light, we shall have fellowship with one another. And a few years after the building was built, a Reformation historian of mine at the University of Wisconsin, Lee Wandel, told me that it was John Calvin's view that the best symbol or image for God is light, because light is, I'll use the traditional word, uncircumscribable. It's got no boundaries. You can't draw the boundaries. Lee Wandel has argued in several papers that the reason that the early Calvinist churches were so light inside is that they were consciously putting into practice this view of Calvin. And she says that whereas a person familiar with traditional Catholic churches reads the Calvinist churches as empty, empty of sculpture, empty of images, empty of almost everything, Wandel argues that they should in fact be read rather as chock full of something else, namely light. Be all that as it may, we on the committee asked Burkitz to design the building in such a way that the person entering it would have the sense of coming into the light. And this he did. So now let me describe for you, and finally we're going to show them right away, how he achieved this. This will also enable me to explain how he achieved the balance between verticality and horizontality. The post that Burkitz said he wanted in order to shorten the length of the spans is in fact a tree. a steel column with branches off the branches and branches off those branches. And these branches support a translucent peak rising to a considerable height above the flat ceiling, the base of the peak being an irregular octagon. And the trunk of the tree, the central trunk of the tree, goes through the point of the peak and is topped by a cross that one sees outside the building. So the tree of life becomes a cross. This peak is made out of that translucent cowl wall, and the entire sanctuary is surrounded at the top by a clerestory. I don't know whether Burkers thought of it as clerestory, but that's what it is. Clerestory made of the same translucent material. Even in bright daylight, there are no shadows somehow in the sanctuary, not even under that translucent peak. And these design features already produce a powerful sense of coming into the light. He used other strategies, three different gradations of grayness in the cement block. The darkest is on the outside, the next darkest, and the lightest is on the inside. The drywall behind the tree is painted in off-white. The tree itself is true white. And the liturgical furniture is in front of the tree, and communion is celebrated around the tree. Now, let's Jonathan. Okay, this, so you can see, just the concrete floor, polished concrete floor, waxed concrete floor. You can see some of the clerestory running around the top to your right. Next one. You can see, now we're looking forward at the slightly raised platform and the liturgical furniture. Next one. Okay, here we have a view of that translucent peak. I think we have another view of it. Oh, there you can see the tree better. You see the trunk and then the branches, and then there are branches off the branches. How about the next one? That gives a good picture of the liturgical furniture in front of the tree and the slightly raised platform and the translucent material. Next one. Same thing. How about the next one? Now we're looking from above. These are liturgical dancers. And let's have one in which I think you see the communion circle. Yes, here's the communion circle around the tree, and the minister and an elder are getting ready to pass the bread and the wine to somebody in the circle to have them pass it to the others. May I have 5 more minutes? Yeah, I've gone. There's one more point that has to be mentioned. Sorry about this. Rather often in thinking about the significance of assembling for the liturgy, Christians have implicitly or explicitly distinguished between ordinary secular activities and special sacred activities, and have thought of assembling for the liturgy as leaving behind the ordinary secular activities so as to engage in the special sacred activities. And the interiors of many church buildings and the approaches are designed accordingly. As many of you know, the 20th century witnessed an extraordinary surge of interest in the history and theology of liturgy. And I'm not aware of any writer in this so-called liturgical movement who has affirmed that traditional way of thinking. Most have explicitly rejected it. For example, the great Orthodox liturgical theologian, Alexander Schmemann. And if one looks at actual liturgies, one sees that they simply don't conform to the traditional understanding. Instead of leaving behind our ordinary lives and concerns when assembling, we carry them with us and give them liturgical expression and confession, intercession, and so forth. And when we disperse, we don't leave behind what God and we have done in the liturgy, but bear it with us for guidance, inspiration, consolation, and so forth. When we assemble for the liturgy, we change our orientation, as it were. When we work in the world, God is, as it were, behind our back. Now we turn around to face God. But we don't leave secular activities to engage in sacred activities. So more could be said on that, but we gave Burkers the assignment of designing the building and its surroundings so as to fit this understanding of the relation between liturgy and life. Our lives as dispersed should flow naturally into our liturgical assemblies, and our assemblies should flow naturally into our lives as dispersed. Once again, I think Burkert succeeded marvelously. Starting from that tree, moving out at angles to each other, there are two powerful axes that extend way out into beyond the parking lot. So they, if you starting from outside, they converge on the trees. Starting from inside, they diverge. From outside, one can see along each of these axes straight ahead through glass doors to the tree, and from inside, you can see from the tree through those glass doors along the axes. Let's get some indication of this. It's not very good, but here's one axis. You can just barely see the glass doors in the distance. The axis is strengthened by having these poles with banners. Now let's just have a few others of the exterior. It's in a residential neighborhood, and Berkerts did not want it to stick out like a sore thumb from the residential neighborhood. So it uses ordinary materials, what is it, T111, so forth. There you can see the peak. You can you cannot see the cross at the top. I'm sorry about that. Maybe one more, Jonathan? Okay. Let me close. The stated topic of our conference is art and sacred space. What would it be for a space to be sacred? Not for a place to be sacred, I talked about that, but for an interior space to be sacred. Earlier I made reference to van der Leeuw's fascinating book, Sacred and Profane Beauty. With fascinating examples, van der Leeuw develops the thesis that whereas religion and art were once inextricably connected, in the modern world they've pulled apart. Joel was also making that point. He then asks whether there's any hope of their coming back together. Such reunion, he says, cannot take the form of replicating what was once the case. It would have to take the form, he suggests, of art that is expressive of the holy, of art that, my word, fits the holy. And he gives lots of examples. One of the most obvious, I suppose, being that stupendous Sanctus from Bach's B minor Mass. So what do you think? Can a bounded interior space be expressive of the holy or the sacred? Suppose I presented to you various examples of bounded interior spaces. Could you rank them in terms of which are more fitting to the holy or sacred and which are less fitting? Are some of them intensely fitting to the sacred? How fitting does it seem to you to the sacred is the interior bounded space of Church of the Servant? Should it have been more fitting than it is? Should we have given Berkerts the assignment of designing an interior bounded space that is intensely sacred? Apart from functional considerations, should that have been our main requirement? Should we have asked for a sacred space, rather than for a space that enables, enhances, and fits the liturgy as we perform and practice it? I'm going to leave it to you to answer those questions.
Thank you. And we have about 15, 20 minutes for a discussion, so I'm going to invite our two presenters to join me up in front of these director's chairs. When I was a boy, I think the phrase that children should be seen and not heard was still one that was bandied about, and I think my job in this event is to be as unobtrusive as possible. So I will ask if there was something in the presentation of the other one of the presenters that struck you as particularly intriguing, or if there was a question you wanted to ask of each other.
Well, I guess my question is, would you apply these same ideas to other religions besides Christianity, or the unique? So
what I mean, if it's a religion that in which there are assemblies, then certainly, yeah.
Yeah, well, most of them do.
And most of them do.
So, like, if you looked at a mosque, you know, they seem to have a commonality. What does that express that's different than Christianity?
I haven't been in enough mosques to give a responsible answer to that question, Joel.
Okay.
I wish I had been, but well, I've got some idea, but I better pass on that one. What would you say?
Well, I would just say that there are some, you know, there's this you get this overwhelming sense of unity, which is the, I think, the thing about Islam that I think is very powerful. You know, the dome.
Yeah, the dome.
And then, of course, the fact that there's no images.
Yep.
And everything is very geometric.
Yep.
Which, you know, I mean, I always think that sometimes Islam is Judaism on steroids. You know, there's a tremendously more intense sense of monotheism, you know, than let's say, you know, Judaism, which has got more of a, it's more tribal and very fractured, obviously.
And then, of course, we have Hagia Sophia, which is the built as a Christian
right.
church, providing the model in a good many ways for the mosque of Islam.
Right. Well, that, I mean,
what's so it really reinforces what I was saying. I gave you one congregation, its understanding of liturgy and its liturgy and what design considerations that led to. What was going on in Hagia Sophia was very different from what goes on in Church of the Servant.
Right, and we see the same thing in the synagogues. You know, you'll have synagogues. The one I went to was a Reform synagogue, which was very Germanic and very, my dad would refer to it as St. Israel's. You know, because it was very much in the model of a high church German, because these were, you know, it was founded by German Jews who were very assimilated. And then if you go to many of the other synagogues, particularly in my neighborhood, which tend to be Sephardic, those are actually much more like mosques. So
what struck me in Joel's talk, reminded me, was the sea change that has come over the Western world, where now our temples are, three sorts of temples, primarily commercial buildings, secondly, big spectator sport arenas, and third, let's face it, our art museums are those three. And it gives me a sense of enormous regret, nostalgia. Once upon a time, you were mentioning it, the medieval cathedral city, the cathedral was, everything about it said that what goes on in that cathedral is central.
Right.
And the early New England towns on the green,
right.
There was a prominent congregational church. You showed an interesting photo of San Francisco in the foreground were some houses. In the far distance, one saw a peak. And my first thought, but it went past very quickly, is, oh, that's the peak of one of the churches. And then I said, no, I think it's the Transamerica building.
Yeah, it is. It is a Transamerica building. And I think, you know, you're talking, I mean, one of this, you know, I think this idea that art had been so united. I mean, when I was doing the city, what was interesting to me was the people were writing, they were not necessarily religious people, but the presence of the religious was so powerful. And now somebody can write a 1,000-page book on the history of cities and barely mention religion once. And it really shows you how our consciousness has, well, you can either evolved or degraded, depending on how you want to put it. That's something that, and I think for art, I think what's happened is art, you know, has really lost that sense of it's almost as much as often as not anti-religious or counter-religious.
I remember reading that book and finding it enormously impressive in many ways, but having the same thought. My conclusion was that this was utterly deliberate on his part, that he knew very well the centrality of Christianity in the histories of the West and of Islam in the histories of the East and so forth. So I had to, don't you think a deliberate writing out of that part of the actual history?
Well, according to friends of mine in London, that he actually, when I made that critique, he said he actually had missed it. But I don't know how you miss it. You know, it's kind of big, particularly, you know, anyone who knows London, you know, London is, you know, defined by great churches, you know, I think it also is how academia works today. It's like so many issues, whether it's on the planning issue, about the family, academia increasingly expresses its own theology, if you will, and imposes it on everything else, almost like the exact opposite of the old Catholic Church.
So here's an example in which, I've said it to some of you before, here's an example in which the history should be reclaimed. The way the history is told is just yes. is just false.
Right, totally, and I think, in a way, I think that we changed history in part because legitimately groups had been left out. The perspective of Native Americans, let's say, being completely left out and marginalized, African Americans, I mean, a lot of things. But now we've gone to this other realm of history where we've almost changed it into something almost like, you remember during the Soviet Union, you and I can remember the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union, because I asked my kids of the Soviet Union, what's that? But in the Soviet Union, how they would keep changing the textbooks, and they take people's, the photographs out and change the photograph. Who was actually walking with Lenin at that time? Well, it was Trotsky, but you put Stalin in instead. So I think that we've sort of recreated this history, and what's so sad is then that's what's being taught. Now, maybe not so much here, but certainly at Yale, certainly at other major universities, my alma mater, the Berkeley. And we've reconstructed history, and now we've reconstructed urban history, for instance, to leave out this entire discussion as if it didn't matter.
It's just falsification.
And the question is, where does it lead? You know, if we can't ask these questions.
Well, if a well-known history of the world cities is written like that, then it's not so surprising that Irvine, when it does its initial planning, is going to say, oh, it never occurred to us to have churches. The architectural community has been thought to think that the churches are unimportant.
See, now what's very interesting is the Woodlands outside of Houston, they had a very different idea. They built churches, and not only did they build churches, but George Mitchell, the founder of the Woodlands, asked a Protestant minister from Philadelphia to come down to Houston and start something called Interfaith, which was to connect all the churches in the Woodlands to provide social services. So essentially, social services in the Woodlands are provided by religious organization, sort of an interfaith religious organization. So there are people who think differently, but I think Howard had mentioned during dinner about, Andrea Stuani and the new urbanists, the word religion along with the word family is almost non-existent. And you just wonder, well, what have been the basis of society? And then we wonder why we move towards a kind of nihilism.
Joel, I think it's true that in your book, the city, you posit that the sacred is linked to somehow to the moral purpose or civic
right.
duty of a city, and those that are great and endure have something besides a vapid self-interest. So could you unpack that idea a little bit more for us?
Well, I mean, one of the things that I've noticed when I look at cities that succeed, their business communities tend to be very involved in, for instance, I'll take Houston, a city I know pretty well. They have one of the few places in America where more Catholic schools are being built because of the business community. They built the largest medical center in the world. They've really taken a city that had been not well considered and done, whether it was in the arts or in religion, they had done some tremendous things. This idea of a civic community that does a lot with a sense of purpose. And that you find that with all great cities. I mean, great cities are built of people who have that kind of drive. In New York, you could think of not only the museum. I was just a couple of weeks ago with my youngest at Museum of Natural History. And, the Theodore Roosevelt and that whole group building this tremendous institution, which is globally important. Or, St. Patrick's Cathedral the Riverside Synagogue. There were so many, and those institutions are like the bright spots of a city. I mean, if you look, and then sometimes we do it wrong. Have you been to the Our Lady of the Angels in downtown LA?
No.
Now, this is a...
Downtown L.A.?
Downtown L.A. It's the cathedral. Have anybody...
No. I'd love to, but I haven't. No.
It's really worth seeing. Yep. Because inside, it is one of the great spaces, modern spaces I've seen anywhere. Outside, it looks like a Home Depot. And so, internally, it works, but externally, it does nothing for the city. And I don't know if that's a common characteristic that these places are... I mean, what I really liked about, the great churches, let's say in Antwerp or elsewhere, is they were part of the plaza and the civic life.
Right. I was talking mainly about the interiors. Also, at the end there, about the liturgical, theological significance of assembling and dispersing. But traditionally, in the New England town, in the cathedral city, of course, they were part of the fabric of urban space, that is, the space created among and between the buildings. They weren't just dropped there with just, innocuous stuff around them. The New England towns, I mean, the whole surrounding said something about the significance of that church being located there and about those houses being arranged on that grid plan and so forth. Our cities now are, well, our cities say something, of course. What they say is that we are consumers. Exactly. And that we like to get together for sports spectacles.
Right, and I think it's just, there's one class that does that, and there's one class that goes to the art museum.
Yeah.
But they, neither of them are engaged in other activities necessarily, and I think that the great, the unifying aspect of the city, doing things that benefit the city. One of the interesting, I am a little stuck on Amsterdam in the 18th century.
So am I. I'm stuck on Amsterdam in the 20th century, actually.
Amsterdam, they were the first ones with poorhouses and the first ones for, treating the insane. I mean, there was tremendous civic effort that was done. And by the way, not just by the Protestants, by the Catholics, by the Jews who also lived in Amsterdam. And that's what makes a great city to me. That's what a great city is about. It's about the internal life of the people who live there and what they do externally.
I'm a philosopher, not an architect. Here would be my motto, if I were an architect. It comes from the Old Testament book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah 29, verse 7. Jeremiah is speaking to his fellow Jews who are exiles in Babylon. The word shalom gets translated in most English Bibles as peace. A wretched translation, in my view. I think our closest English word is flourishing. Okay? Shalom is flourishing. Here's what Jeremiah says. Seek the shalom of the city, for in its shalom you shall find shalom. Hmm. That's what the architect should aim at.
And that's what's missing.
Yes.
And I think it's, and when people think about how they are going to develop a city, they're just not thinking about that at all. And I think I would challenge you to look at 100 urban textbooks or architectural textbooks and see how much they talk about churches or they talk about even the philanthropic impulse. I don't think you'll see it.
So I think...
And they don't talk then about how to design a city in which its inhabitants and the community both can flourish.
Yeah, I don't think I think you use the term mechanistic.
Yeah, I mean, you just used the term philanthropic, so I'm guessing, I think this is true, it's an accurate guess, that this moral purpose, it's got to be altruistic in some way. Right. I mean, Rome merged service with empire, a nice thing if you can get away with it. It's to your benefit that we're conquering you, and we offer these, right. We provide you with these civilizing accoutrements, and the sacred space in Rome advertised that.
Right.
And it wasn't simply the magnification of our power, but of the beneficence. So, and I was thinking even of the cathedral in L.A. I mean, the old one was St. Viviana's was often. Bunker Hill and down in what's now sort of Skid Row. So, yeah. I mean, it was a conscious attempt to say that there is importance for city life for us to be at the center, right, hanging over the freeway.
Well, but of course, to give them some credit, the church did want to rebuild where Viviana's was.
Yeah.
And it was the preservationist said, no, you can't do it. And Viviana's was really not such a great church, not that it's for me to judge. But the fact is that had I had always, and I had written about this in the Times at the time, that what Los Angeles, which is now a profoundly Catholic city, with a profoundly Latin heritage, that we should have a great cathedral in the middle of the city as part of the mix, and as somebody who's not a Catholic at all, I would have advocated that. And of course, the other funny thing is, this is a great story, which is we have the County of LA, and one of our emblems in the County of LA is a mission church, and they made them take the cross off. So I said, now we have a Taco Bell.
Well, we're just about out of time, but I thought I would maybe ask one more question. It's hopefully quite open-ended. You know, ancient cities, the estimates are 35% to 50% of the space within the walls was devoted to monumental architecture, public space, and the sacred. And then I think about our story about Irvine, where there was none allocated for that. So, well, what's lost for us as a civilization, and how do we recapture that?
Well, the other way to think about it is that, in fact, we still have monumental buildings. New York is chock full of monumental buildings, but all the monumental ones, almost all the monumental ones, are devoted to commerce, or to recreational sports, or to museums, concert halls. But the big monumental ones are, the ones that stick out on the skyscape, are so that we still have monumental ones, they've just changed their character.
But I do think that you can do a better job. The Rockefeller Center, you know, which has a public space where, you know, people can go skating and where there's a really open to everyone and has some gorgeous finishes.
It does.
You know, that really tells you that you can still embrace modernity and have a sense of civic purpose and spirituality. And the problem is they don't teach it in the architecture schools.
So it's you and I who have to urge the architecture schools to start teaching it.
Yeah, well, I don't know how much of an audience we'll have with them because, you know, it's really almost like an anti-theology that is now in place. So it's not even like we're going to debate about this. The idea of the sacred space does not even exist in concept. And, you know, I guess our job is to try to make sure that they can't get away with it completely.
And instead of building for seeking the shalom, we, so far as I can see, build for the powerful who have the money to call the shots.
Mm-hmm. And to entertain the...
And to entertain.
Your call, Ben.
Yeah, I think that was against the rules, but I'm not a very good rule follower myself, so go ahead, yeah.
I'm curious, we have this community that's being developed, Centennial, north of Valencia, and I'm just curious, that's a brand new city, and what would your recommendation be if you have it here, since you know that land and the selling of their land is all you know market-driven, it's residual land value and so forth. How might you design such a city so that there could be these sacred spaces? It would make sense to the publicly owned the landowners and so forth so that they could essentially make the profit that they want on that land, but at the same time have the community be centered around sacred spaces, you know, given our fairly broad religious base here in the country now.
Well, from what I understand, Centennial's still having lots of problems with the planning authorities. And given the current planning regime in California, I don't know if they'll ever get built. But I can give you an example of some place where having a major church made a big difference, and that is at Porter Ranch out in the San Fernando Valley, where the construction of a large Korean church, Christian church, created an enormous community of Koreans who now live in that area, and you know, and of course, the we're beneficiaries because they're good Korean restaurants not far away. But you know, so we can tell that building those, you know, those kind of churches has enormous appeal. Not far from me is the largest Thai temple in the United States, maybe 10 minutes from my house. And that's created a whole Thai community. So I think these people, sometimes the developers and planners should think about how these become sort of institutions that then replenish their communities. And so I would say if in Centennial, the question is whether, whether having one or two of these kinds of churches would have appeal. The big appeal that I see is the churches, particularly the Asian Christian churches, because those are very strong communities. And if you can get people to move out, that really will make a difference. At least that's what we saw in Porter Ranch.
Well, let's thank our guests for a stimulating evening. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this message. Biola University offers a variety of biblically-centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Learn more at biola.edu.